Good evening, everyone. On behalf of the team, Calcutta Comparatists 1919, I take this privilege to warmly welcome you to the ninth session of a webinar series. Calcutta Comparatists 1919 is an independent forum for research scholars of humanities and social sciences. It carries the legacy of academic space for literary comparison between Indian languages initiated in 1919. It is a platform for sharing research interests and ideas. We are organizing online lectures on various interdisciplinary topics to be delivered by academicians and distinguished research scholars of different fields. Thank you for joining us today. Now I would like to request our host, Aratrika Ganguly, to take over the mic. Aratrika Didi.
Yeah, thank you, Suparna. Welcome, everyone. Very good evening. Today we have as our speaker, Dr. Nishi Pulugartha. Dr. Nishi is the head and associate professor in the Department of English, Brahmananda Keshav Chandra College, and has taught courses at West Bengal State University as well as Rabindra Bharati University. Her research areas are British Romantic literature, postcolonial literature, Indian writing in English, literature of the diaspora, and film. She is also a creative writer and writes on various topics like travel, Alzheimer's disease, films, short stories, as well as poetry. Her work has been published in The Statesman, Kolkata, in the anthology Tranquil Muse, and in an online journal of Cafe Dissensus, Old Noon, Queen's Mom's Tea House, as well as Shetu. She guest edited the 2018 issue of Cafe Dissensus. Now I welcome Nishi ma'am. Ma'am, please, can you start now?
Good evening. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, you're audible.
Okay, I would first like to thank Kolkata Comparatists 1919 for this wonderful endeavor that they have begun. And I would, of course, like to thank Jemima for insisting that I should come and speak. She was very insistent when she spoke with me, and she was reluctant to take no for an answer. And she wanted me to speak on Telugu literature. I should make this very clear right at the outset, is that I'm no expert on Telugu literature. I told Jemima this when she asked me to talk. And I'm very thankful that she insisted, because I went back to a text which I read quite some years ago and spoke about it at a translation seminar many years ago. So I'm very glad that I was able to go back to that text and, once again reread that text, because I was going to introduce you to that text and talk to you about it. So thank you to Kolkata Comparatists and to Jemima in particular. Now, this text that I'm going to talk about, Kanya Sulkam, this is an iconic text, Telugu text, and I have the English translation. Quite a number of English translations available. The first one was done by Sahitya Academy. Then there has been this one, which I have, which was done by Velchuri Narayan Rao. And there is another one which was done by C. Vijayashri and T. Vijay Kumar some years ago. So it is a very, very important Telugu play written in the 19th century. So I will be trying to introduce this text. I don't have a PowerPoint presentation, so I'm going to talk mostly. And in case you have any questions, any comments, anything that you want to add, I'm more than open to all of them, because I would definitely want this particular presentation to be interactive. So I begin, I just titled my talk, Reading Gurjar Appara's Kanya Sulkam. I'm not going to focus on any one particular aspect of the text, but I'm going to introduce the entire text in the context of the times that it was written. And I'll be talking about the various themes and the way the play was written and the reception of the play also in Telugu literature and as well as in Telugu culture as well. By the late 19th century, there had been quite a number of social and literary movements underway in all parts of India, so also in the southern part of India and in the Madras Presidency. I refer to the Madras Presidency because the state of the erstwhile undivided state of Andhra Pradesh, presently since 2014, it is now Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, they all had been part of the Madras Presidency. And as you know, I mean, if you look at 19th century literature in Bengal, or if you look at society and education at that point of time, this is something which is common, and that is that English education was much sought after. However, this was predominantly sought after by the upper caste, particularly by the Brahmin families, who were attracted to the political power that such education gave them. And they coveted the various economic benefits that accrued from it. Now, I refer to the Brahmin class out here because this play focuses, of course, there are people from various castes, but the central characters, the majority of the characters belong to this Brahmin family, Brahmin families, because this practice of Kanya Sulkam, bride price, that is, a girl is got married to an older man, the older man had to pay for the price of this girl, right? So this practice of Kanya Sulkam was very rampant in these upper caste Brahmin families. The 19th century, as elsewhere in India, also in South India, and predominantly in this region of then undivided Andhra, Andhra was born much later on in 1950, but in those regions, in regions of Vijayanagaram, where Gurjar Appara belonged to Vijayanagaram, I will also be referring to Rajahmundry, because one of the very important social reformers of the time, a man by the name of Kandukuri Veerasalingam, belonged to Rajahmundry. So this was the time when you had lot of reform movements, lots of reformers at work. I refer to Kandukuri Veerasalingam because I want to situate the text, Kanya Sulkam, in this scenario of social reform, because that was one of the reasons why Gurjar Appara wrote this play. Kandukuri Veerasalingam was born in the Godavari Delta town of Rajahmundry. He studied, he was educated in English and in Telugu, traditional Telugu literature, and he took a very active lead in advocating social reform among his community, among the Brahmin community of Andhra. He was working predominantly to improve the status of Brahmin women by arranging marriages of young widows whose husbands had died, you know, when they were much younger. So you see, you find the same kind of thing happening in Bengal and other parts of India as well. He also led a movement against a caste which was called the Vaityas, the courtesans or the dancing girls. And I refer to this because the dancing girl, the character of the dancing girl or the notch girl, is an important character in this play. They were also called Bogam Vallu, meaning pleasure women. Arguing, and the common argument about them was that they lived a sinful life by, indulging in sexual pleasures. These two movements with which Kandukuri Veerasalingam was very closely associated, they were popularly known as the widow remarriage and the anti-notch movements. These two forms of reform, social activism with which he was involved, were very popular. They were favored by a section of English educated people, Telugu people, who were brought up on these new Christian morals, new Christian values, which was imparted by the English education. So this was a result of the English education. Rajahmundry, where Veerasalingam lived and worked, was directly ruled by a British collector, and it boasted a government college with an Englishman as a principal. So the cultural scene in Rajahmundry was much less supportive of conventional scholarship, and it was more accepting of an English-style education and its cultural after effects. And in the text, in the play that I'll be talking about, we will be seeing, you know, this English education forms an important part of the text as well, of the play as well. A recent dam built on the River Godavari by an enterprising British engineer from Oxfordshire, Sir Arthur Cotton, had made the entire region around the river very fertile. The Godavari Delta area, it's called Kona Seema, is an extremely fertile land. It's called the rice basin of Andhra. Right. And with the building of the dam, you know, it becomes even more fertile. Upper caste families who owned land enjoyed new wealth and along with it new opportunities for an English education in the newly established schools. The first college graduates in erstwhile undivided Andhra came from this particular area. This is the place where Virasalingam begins to work. His message of social reform and the need to speak about an upliftment of Hindu society from the moral degradation in which he found it steeped found a sympathetic following in the government's art college at Rajahmundry, where he taught. He also acquired a position. He had a position of influence in the colonial administration, and he had a popularity among the emerging English-educated middle class. However, he did face opposition from the Orthodox Brahmins because they were vehemently protesting against any kind of reform. And they believed that it was sinful for them to deviate from the path prescribed in their traditional texts and traditions, which regulated social behavior. In the play, we will have quite a number of characters, many of whom will be talking about and advocate the modern, the new English education. And there will be a group of people, Brahmins, who speak vehemently for the traditional school of learning, the Vedas and Sanskrit learning and so on. The society in which these debates were conducted was predominantly upper caste. The vast majority of the lower caste did not count in these discussions. And for the upper classes, the lower caste does not exist at all. And this is the social and political context in which Virasalingam worked. He was a dynamic leader, very courageous social activist, prolific writer as well. He made a name for himself among the educated Telugu elite. He wrote literature. He wrote around 16 plays, edited and published a magazine, which is called Vivekavardhini. And so he's not only a social reformer, not only someone who spoke against child marriages, who spoke for and advocated widow remarriages, who spoke against all kinds of social evils prevalent in society, but he also wrote literature. So he is a literary, he is well known in Telugu literature as well. Now, the first phase of Telugu theater, if you try to situate the play in the context of Telugu theater, the first phase of Telugu theatre was marked by a lot of influence of Sanskrit and English dramatic texts. Most of the writings were either inspired by Sanskrit or English texts or translations. During this time, there's this gentleman called Kondubatla Subramaniam Sastri, who wrote about 31 plays, but they were written in prose in Telugu. He also started the theatre group called the Hindu Nataka Samajam at Guntur, and he staged a number of performances. In 1883, a poet and playwright, Vaddadi Subbaraidu, he began another group called the Hindu Nataka Jivika Samajam. And this gentleman is the one who is responsible for introducing verse into drama. It is during this time also that the famous Harvard Theatre Company called Altekar Hindu Dramatic Company toured some of the coastal districts and performed their plays. Their performance in Rajahmundry inspired local amateurs to performances of their own, and this also resulted in Kandukuri Virasalingam taking an initiative to form a theatre group with his own students, and he even staged one of his own plays in, I think, 1880. And this play was called Vyavahara Dharma Bodhini. And the play talks about the corrupt nature of lawyers. Gurujara Venkat Rao Apparao was born in 1861, and he was born in the northern part of Andhra in Vijayanagaram. He studied at Maharaja College in Vijayanagaram, and he did his matriculation and his FA, after which he found it difficult to continue his education. It is then that he held a number of minor positions, including that of a school teacher for some time, and later on managed to complete, with the help of the principal of the college, he completed his BA in philosophy and Sanskrit in 1886. Luckily for him, the Maharaja of Vijayanagaram was a great patron in town, and the Maharaja appointed Gurujara Appa Rao as a lecturer in a college on a salary of 100 rupees. However, Gurujara, was also got some more money because he was asked to read the newspapers for the Maharaja every day. The Maharaja has a very important role, which is why I'm talking about it, because he encouraged Gurujara to write this play. Also, the Maharaja had an active interest in social reform. So from that day, from the day that he joined the college till he died in 1915, Gurujara Appa Rao served the royal family in various capacities. He was a newspaper reader for the Maharaja. He was the royal epigraphist. And after the death of the Maharaja of Vijayanagaram, Anand Gajapati Raju, he became the personal assistant and advisor to the Maharaja's widowed sister, and for some time also acted as a Diwan, as the Diwan of Vijayanagaram. His career in literature began somewhat during his school days when he began to write poetry in English. And he wanted to establish himself as an English poet. However, encouraged by his friends, he also began writing in Telugu. He was very much involved in various developments in world theatre. He studied Sanskrit plays, and he had a keen observant eye. As I was reading through, I found that he had corresponded with Rabindranath Tagore at one point of time, and an entry in his diary suggests that he may have corresponded with George Bernard Shaw as well. Apart from Kanya Sulkam, there are two versions of the play, Gurujara also wrote two more plays, both of which were left unfinished. He also wrote some short stories and a small number of poems and songs. Now, Gurujara Appa Rao is recognized, is acknowledged as the pioneer of modernism in Telugu literature. Right. He is the first person who uses not the stylized Telugu, but the language that the common people use. The Vyavaharika Bhasha is the one that he uses. Right. Modernism in the context of Telugu literature may be identified with four interrelated trends. There's a self-reflexivity about the socio-cultural institutions resulting in a movement from orthodoxy, a reform in the use of language, a quest for newer forms of literary expression, and the growing significance of prose forms as a direct means of dissemination of ideas and ideologies. And when you read Kanya Sulkam, it exemplifies all these trends and represents the essential spirit of the time in which it was written. The play makes a very strong plea against the system of bride price, the Sulka practice, Kanya Sulkam, the practice of selling girls as brides to old men. The play also succeeded, as I said, in fashioning a colloquial idiom suitable for dramatic presentation, unlike the earlier forms of Telugu plays, which used a very stylized literary language. Gurujara chose comedy. The play is a comedy. He chose comedy to protest against social stigmas like bride price. A serious social like Kanya Sulkam, which raised its ugly head during this time, is portrayed in this play satirically by he uses wit, humor, and irony to speak of this. He was moved by the evil practices of what he saw around him at that point of time. And Kanya Sulkam is an effort at social reform. Girls of 10 years younger, a little bit older, were married off to men of say 65 years old or even older for sums of say 1,000 rupees. These girls soon landed up as being widows, and these child widows led a pathetic existence. As you know, widowhood in the Indian context is a kind of social ostracism almost. So in the play, he speaks about the pain, the agony, the frustration, the grief of these widows, who range from much younger to widows in their 20s and 30s. And the play unveils the tyranny of late 19th century society, caught between the collapse of an older cultural order and the uncertain emergence of a new one. The Maharaja of Vijayanagara, Mananda Gajapati Raju, he was very concerned with this practice of Kanyasulkam, which was prevalent here in Vijayanagaram in Orthodox Brahmin communities. And this is what Gurjara writes when in the acknowledgement to the play. He writes, under the orders of His Highness, the Maharaja of Vijayanagaram, a list was prepared 10 years ago, Brahmin Sulka marriages celebrated in the ordinary tracts of the Visakhapatnam district during 3 years. The number of marriages recorded reached 1,034, giving an average of 344 per year. 99 girls were married at the age of 5 years, 44 at 4. The babies in the last instance carrying a price from 350 to 400 rupees a head. Strange as it may sound, bargains are sometimes struck for children in the womb. Unquote. Anand Gajapati Raju, as I said, was very conscious of this. He was a scholar. He could read Sanskrit, he could read Persian, he was a connoisseur of poetry and the arts, and he gathered around him some of the greatest scholars at that point of time. So this is the atmosphere in which he writes, Gurjara writes Kanyasulkam. The first version of Kanyasulkam, when he writes this, he writes a letter to the first version where he dedicates this play to the Maharaja. The play is very, very interesting in its own right, written with intriguing scenes and lots of drama. And the play, as I said, is more directly oriented towards social reform. Most critics agree that the first version of the play is not that interesting as the second version. The second version was published in 1909. For many years, the play was forgotten. It was completely out of public memory and would have possibly sunk into oblivion if a gentleman called Bandi Gopala Reddy Bangore, as he's called, had not traced it and published it with copious notes. It is this second version of the text that has become famous. It has received unparalleled attention for the past several years and has been uniformly praised for its inimitable charm of its dialogue and for its great characters such as Madhuravani and Girisam, who have become part of popular culture as well. The play deals with young girls being married to older men. Of course, this, as I said, meant early death of the old husbands and consequent widowhood. There was no system of widow remarriage, and therefore the girl had to lead a long life of widowhood, completely cut off from everything, all pleasures and joys. Denied the pleasures of life in the normal course, some of them ended up looking for secret affairs to justify and to satisfy their natural physical desires, that often resulted in abortion. And in this play, there are quite a number of widows, that he depicts, and there he speaks about their condition as well. The play is also about the notch question that was being debated at the end of the 19th century. These dancing girls who enjoyed royal patronage in the 18th and early 19th century were treated very shabbily in the late 19th century and were reduced to the position of prostitutes. One of the central characters in the play, Madhuravani belongs to this. She is a notch girl. So the purpose of writing the play was to arouse public opinion against this practice, these practices, by exposing the evils in a popular drama. Apart from these social evils, the play also deals with the effect of British colonialism on Telugu society. And this effect is seen in the realms of education and culture. So the play will also be, within the play, we'll also have the conflict between Indian attitudes towards English education, the debates concerning the advantages and disadvantages of some aspects of English education. While some characters in the play recognize English as a language of opportunity, as a language that gives them social class and prejudice, others comment on its domination of indigenous cultures and traditions. English gives a certain position and power to some of the characters. For example, one of the most interesting characters in the play, Girisan. The use of local dialect, the portrayal of incidents which are akin to real life situations, the addressing of social problems and the possible solutions and cultural reformation are the main features of this play. As Gurjara himself writes, and I quote, "Modern life, which presents complex social conditions, is neglected by playwrights except for purposes of the broadest farce. And poverty of invention is manifested by the handling of threadbare romantic topics. Few writers display knowledge of technique." This is what he writes. So the plot of the play, Kanya Sulkam, revolves around the desire of an elderly Brahmin who is called Lubdha Avadhanulu. Lubdha also means someone who is miserly. This old man wants a new bride. So he has to buy a new bride. To buy as his new bride, the very young daughter, Subbi, of another Brahmin. This gentleman's name is Agnihotra Avadhanulu. Now, Agnihotra Avadhanulu is determined to get his younger daughter married to this older man, of course, because he's more interested in the money, right? This is a deal. He's determined to go through with the deal. But the girl's mother is staunchly opposed to this match, since her elder daughter, Butchamma, is already widowed. And the mother asks her brother, a gentleman called Karkata Sastri, to do something to stop this marriage, or else she'll kill herself because she does not want to see her younger daughter also widowed early. So Karkata Sastri thinks of a ruse. He has to think of a plan. So part of his plan is this, that he disguises a young boy, his disciple, a young man called Mahesam. He disguises him as a girl and he offers to get her to marry Lubdha Avadhanulu for a cheaper price, right? See, the old man is looking for a bride, right? The bride has to be young and the bride has to be a Brahmin because he is a Brahmin. And he knows that he has to pay the sulka price for the bride. So if he gets a bride for a much lesser amount of money, then it's a good deal for Lubdha Avadhanulu. So that is the plot that Karkata Sastri thinks of. Now this disciple Mahesam is well trained in the art of disguising himself as a woman, because he had worked in the theater. And as you know, in theater, women's roles were played by men. So he's got this habit. He has played a number of women's roles in theater. So this drama of this masquerade is managed by the deft manipulations of the notch girl, Madhuravani, who is a central character in the play. To make the plan work, Madhuravani manipulates the various men who seek sexual favors from her. You know, Lubdha Avadhanulu, Agnihotra Avadhanulu, and Girisam. She manipulates all of them. All of them visit her at various times. All of them are drawn to her charms. And she works in such a way so as to manipulate all of them in order to make this plan work, so that Subbi is saved from getting married, from forcefully being married off to an older man. After the wedding is done, the new bride, who we know is a boy in disguise, disappears. A corrupt police establishment charges Lubdha Avadhanulu with murder, and we have a staunch social reformist and idealist lawyer, a man called Saujanya Rao, who defends Lubdha Avadhanulu but finds his case in deep trouble because there is no evidence to prove the innocence of his client. Interwoven with this plot is another plot, the love life of Girisam, another central character, who is a young and handsome con artist with a glib tongue and a flair for the English language. In public, he preaches social and moral reform. However, he has a secret affair with a young widow who runs an eating house, and he frequents Madhuravani, who is his pleasure woman. He owes money to almost everyone in town, and he doesn't have the money to repay them. So he escapes to Agnihotra Avadhanulu's village under the pretext of tutoring Agnihotra Avadhanulu's son in English during this summer vacation. He cons the family into believing that he is an educated man, a highly educated man. And this is the time when Agnihotra Avadhanulu is making all kinds of arrangements to marry his little daughter Subbi to this 70-year-old man against the wishes of all the other women in the family. Girisam pretends to help the women to escape this disaster. He seduces Butchamma and he elopes with her the night before the wedding. So you can understand he's not a good character, definitely. The last act has Madhuravani in a man's guise going to this lawyer Saujanya Rao's house at night where Girisam has been staying. He has just eloped with Butchamma and is pretending to be a sincere young activist in the movement for social reform, and he's seeking Saujanya Rao's support to marry Butchamma. The unexpected stranger who shows up, Madhuravani, who's disguised as a man, as they are talking to, in Saujanya Rao's bedroom, she tells the lawyer that she has come on she's disguised as a man, so he has come on an important and sensitive matter, and enters into a conversation with them. And it is because of her that Butchamma is saved. So the central event of the play is the wedding of a child to an old man, a social evil that most social reformers in 19th century Andhra were talking against. As soon as such a wedding is announced, the whole village, cutting across all castes, unites to prevent it from happening. From the priest to the policeman, from the servants to the schoolboys, everyone, including the bridegroom's own daughter, right? And she's a much older daughter, and the bridegroom's widowed daughter. Even she joins hands to foil it, and they make a fool of the cunning middleman who has arranged it, and this septuagenarian groom who is foolish enough to fall for the idea. All of them strongly believe they do not want another child widow in this society, which has seen so many widows, and the condition of these widows is terrible, and this is something which is common all over India in the 19th century. Gurudwara depicts a variety of relationships between men and women. He depicts a population from many walks of life. It's a big play. From many walks of life, we have a number of characters who are negotiating the best outcomes for themselves and living with positive, uninhibited, robust energy. The characters are not mouthpieces. They are not voicing dramatic spokespersons for voicing his ideologies. No, they are flesh and blood individuals, right? So they are characters who are, fully rounded characters who go through extraordinary changes politically and culturally, who are making a lot of adjustments to maintain the quality of their lives. And the two most important changes that touch their lives are the colonial administrative system and the language in which it is conducted. So English is a very, very important aspect of the play as well. The two important parts of the government that touch nearly everyone in society are the police and the courts. The head constable and through him the police inspector have very important roles in the play. We also hear a lot about the British style courts, where disputes are settled in various ways which people don't understand. The language in which laws were written was English, and very few people understood it. The English language was not easily accessible to all. It was expensive, and schools that teach it were mostly located in faraway towns and cities. So it was not accessible to people in the villages. However, as we see throughout the play, the English language is both eagerly coveted and severely resisted. I'll just refer to certain one particular episode with which the play begins. The Kanyasulkam begins with Venkatesam, who is the young son of this orthodox Brahmin, Agnihotra Vadanulu. This boy comes home on his vacation. Now he has failed his exams. However, his tutor, who is Girisam, and Girisam is a con man, you know, he does a number of things. He's present in almost all the various plots in the play, all the various episodes in the play. So Girisam, is his tutor, and Girisam assures him that he will lie to his parents about his exam scores. He will teach him during the vacation. He will teach English, and he will see that Venkatesam is able to get admitted into a higher class after the vacation. Right. Now, this system of teachers teaching for a salary, students taking examinations, students, either passing the examination or failing, is again a new system that people are growing accustomed to. The earlier system was where you went to your master who would teach you Sanskrit, and depending on how well you learned it, that would determine whether your education was over or not. Here in the beginning of the play, we hear Venkatesam's father, Agnihotra Vadanulu, complaining to his wife that she has put the boy in an English language school against his wishes. If the boy had stayed at home, he says, he could have taught him a good deal of the Vedas. You know, he is a Brahmin, he would have taught him. This is the traditional education system in which boys learn the family trade, mostly from their fathers. What is the family trade? Performing various rituals and learning the Vedic text, and then teaching the Vedic text to the next set of students. Agnihotra Vadanulu knows the Vedas well and can recite it in very complex ways. That is the skill for which he is respected in his community and by which he makes his living, and he wants his son to follow the same path. But his wife sees the advantages of an English education. She knows that if Venkatesam gets a proper English education, then this would mean that he would get a high paying job in the new administration. She has seen her neighbor's son, who used to play marbles on the street, now making a lot of money as the town munsif. And she wants her son to get a good job in the administration, earn enough money so that he could, you know, buy lots of land in the village and not have a meager, not earn a meager living like his father. What is interesting to note, and this is where you have a lot of the comedy in the play coming out right at the beginning, is the respect that Girisam gets when he speaks English. Now, the rest of the people don't understand what he's saying. So he speaks it with a flair, right? And Venkatesam's mother, she doesn't understand English, but she wants to hear her son and Girisam speak English to one another, right? So she's completely in awe, you know, her son, she's so proud of her son that he's learning English. Now, I'll just read a little bit from the play here so you can understand what they are doing and you can understand what kind of a character Girisam is. So she wants them to speak in English, though she doesn't understand it. She wants to listen to her son and derive pride from the fact that her son is speaking English. So Girisam begins. He's addressing Venkatesam. My dear Venkatesam, twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. And Venkatesam replies, there is a white man in the tent. Girisam, the boy stood on the burning deck whence all but he had fled. Venkatesam says, upon the same base and on the same side of it, the sides of a trapezium are equal to one another. Girisam continues, of man's disobedience and the fruit of that mango tree, sing Venkatesa, my very good boy. So you can understand what they are doing out here. They are conning the poor mother and the poor father, who has no idea of what these people are doing. And this conversation between Venkatesam and Girisam also tells you a lot about Girisam himself, that he is a perfect con man. Karakata Sastri, who is listening to all of this, He's Venkatesan's uncle. He stops and he asks, what is the meaning of all of this? And now there's no meaning, as you can see, right? So Venkatesan looks up to the ceiling because he doesn't know what to say. He's a terrible student. And Girisam intervenes and says, how can a young boy know the meaning of such difficult poems? And that is when Agnihotra Avadhanula intervenes and says, don't they teach the meanings of poems? To which Girisam, with his ready wit, promptly answers. And this is what he says, for now they make them chant the verses like the Veda. In the white man's school, they don't care much for Telugu poems. All the time, they bombard the students with geography, arithmetic, algebra, mathematics, and all that heavy stuff. And Agnihotra Avadhanulu is amazed. He asks, they teach all that? To which Girisam solemnly confirms, yes, sir, all that and more. Now, as I said, it is up to Karakata Sastri to avert this marriage of his niece with this old man. Right, so Venkatam's younger sister is Subbi, who now her father wants to get married to this old man, Lubdhavadanalu. And her mother now recruits her brother, Karakata Sastri, who decides to take the help of his disciple. Now, why is the disciple going to help? So Karakata Sastri promises his disciple Mahesam that he would give his daughter in marriage to his disciple if they succeed in this plan. Right. So you see, this entire idea of marriage in the play is worked out as a deal. And when he promises to Mahesham that he will get his daughter married to Mahesham once this plan succeeds, you know. So Mahesham says, how do I know that you are going to do it? So promise me. So Karakata Shastri picks up an English book, right? And he puts his hand on that and takes an oath. You know, since it's an English book, right? So chances are that he would be sticking to that. And this plan, most people don't know except Madhuravani, who helps Karakata Sastri in this plan because she knows about all of this, and it propels the action of the whole play. Witty, humorous, serious, and devastatingly honest, this is the first realistic Telugu play which depicts a society undergoing radical changes under the influence of colonialism. From the day the play was first staged in 1892, it was published in 1897, and then we had a revised edition in 1909, the play captured the imagination of generations of audiences and readers, Telugu readers, scholars. The 1909 edition, as I said, has been celebrated as one of the greatest works of Telugu literature. It is so popular that most people remember lines from the play, quote lines from the play in conversation. Characters from the play have grown so familiar, have become so much a part of the Telugu popular imagination. When Girisam speaks about, so we have a number of different characters in this particular play, and it has often been compared to Mitcha Katika because it depicts a vibrantly, upwardly mobile society with people from all walks of life, from Veda chanting Brahmins to widows, to various kinds of widows. So we have Bucchamma, we have the widow who runs the eatery, we have corrupt of police officers, we have idealistic lawyers, we have smart courtesans like Madhuravani, cunning village politicians, to dashing young English-speaking dandies, intelligent people from a variety of caste and professions. Girisam uses the word Veda. He is speaking against this mindless memorization of Telugu verses, which Agnihotra Avadhanulu teaches. And Agnihotra Avadhanulu himself has a love-hate relationship with the English language. He says he does not like the English language because he doesn't know it. And he is, he seeks Girisam's help because he needs help to translate some legal papers. He is easily fooled when Girisam flatters him for his knowledge of the law. So the powerful role that the English language has in society also resonates throughout the play. Vreesam fools practically everybody with his fluent English. Right. So the English language is also therefore very, very important. You have Madhuravani, who is equally enamored of it. So she asks Girisam to teach her English, and Girisam decides to teach her so that in return for sexual services that she offers to him. Mahesam, Karkata Sastri's young Sanskrit student and theatre apprentice, has no interest in the Sanskrit Kavya of Kalidasa. He believes that it's old, out of tune with the present times. And he says that it would be better if he would be reading English, if he would be studying English, because what good is this Sanskrit? If you want to make money, then you need to be knowledgeable in the English language. He doesn't even trust a Sanskrit book enough to take an oath on it, and would rather borrow an English book for that purpose from Girisam. The courts, we are told, function according to the new British made laws written in English. All the court papers are in the English language, and most of the clients are totally confused by the names of the codes, by the various sections of the acts and the codes and so on, which are quoted to them by the lawyers. The courts are not seen as places of justice that create respect for the law, but as places where you can freely lie, where there is a lot of corruption. The common comparison is between the lawyer and the prostitute, both of whom sell their services to whoever pays the best price. The idealist lawyer, Saujanya Rao, considers leaving the profession because the system is so corrupt that it cannot be improved. You know, when Lubdha Vadanullu faces the murder charges without a corpse in sight, the top brass of the police, who have internal grudges with the local police, blame the head constable and unjustly accuse him of having covered up a murder in the village. Most people are not affected by what happens in the court, but they face the police day after day. The head constable, for instance, is present everywhere, from the wedding ritual to the courtesan's house, to Lubdha Vadanullu's house, to the local liquor store. He personifies law and order in the village and is feared by everybody. Even the bullock cart driver, whom Girisam lectures for 2 hours about the National Congress, asks if they will transfer the present head constable away from the village. The lawyers, the police, and the English language represent the face of the colonial government in the play. The new elite created by the colonial culture is going through a process of reform in the face of the new standards of conduct. Compared to the world under the impact of English, the society that it is not touched by seems to be doing much better. Its members believe in religion and ritual, but carry no superstitious adherence to it. For instance, the priest Gavaraya produces an elaborate ritual to exorcise the spirit that Lubdha Vadanullu believes has afflicted him. No one except the gullible Lubdha Vadanullu believes it, but everyone is perfectly willing to go along with the drama to teach the miserly old man a lesson. We do have a section of people who are untouched by English education, who are not bothered, who still continue to live with their older kind of life, with their older kind of beliefs. The context in which the first version of the play was created was the Maharaja's interest in social reform. The introduction that Gurjara wrote for the first play indelibly impressed upon the readers that he was vehemently in favor of reforming a decadent Hindu society with its immoral notch girls, pitiable child widows, and decrepit old men who wanted to buy child brides. The cultural atmosphere in the modern metropolitan center of Madras was another factor that influenced the reading of this play. There was a strong wave of colonial modernity in the city, and the social reformer Virasalingam was influential. As I said earlier, his presence in Telugu literature was very, very powerful. A good number of English-educated upper caste people applauded his social activism, and his literary work received attention among the new literati. Gurdwara did not make much of an impact on his contemporaries as a writer. They praised him as a person with worldly wisdom and as a great scholar in the English language, but they failed to see his greatness, his personal style of lying low and not demanding much attention possibly had a lot to do with it. He was much more content representing the Maharaja and later his widowed sister in councils and courts, and was not so much very particular about the literary world. The high point of Gurdwara's popularity in the 20th century possibly began much later in the 1940s and the 1950s, where we had a number of critics beginning to call the 20th century the age of Gurdwara. The influential Marxist critic K.V. Ramana Reddy, who wrote the only well-researched biography of Gurdwara Appa Rao, called his book Mahodayam, which means the Great Dawn, which implied that the period before Gurdwara was a dark age. And slowly, Gurdwara was rapidly transformed into an icon. The famous Telugu progressive poet Sri Sri and his nephew Arudra devoted themselves to elaborately praising Appa Rao, Gurdwara Appa Rao. Sri Sri even wrote, "Follow his footsteps, they are the way to the future. Gurdwara cures us of stupidity in our nature." So Gurdwara began to be perceived as one who sought social progress, wrote against religious superstition and sexual decadence, followed simple meter in his poetry, and wrote his play in a language that avoided the artificial literary dialect prescribed for all writing by pundits of his time, thus paving the way for a great cultural and literary revolution. More specifically, Kanyasulkam was read as a testament to the author's commitment to social change, his rejection of a feudal society, and his condemnation of the sinful profession of pleasure women. In general, his voice was perceived as a clarion call to build a new society on a new moral order. The Girisam character, Girisam is simply seen as a confidence man and trickster who is justly punished at the end. Madhuravani, who is a notch girl, who is a prostitute, is noble at heart. She saves a young girl from marriage to an old woman, and in the end reforms herself to lead a new and morally correct life. Lubdha Vadhanulu, Agnihotra Avadhanulu, and all the other Brahmin folk in the village are seen as representative of a decadent Brahmin culture. The first version of this play, as I said, was staged initially in 1892, 5 years before the play was published. The troupe that produced it was Jagannatha Vilasini Dramatic Company, which performed Sanskrit plays under the patronage of the Maharaja of Vijayanagaram. The decision to perform a Telugu play written in spoken Telugu, Vyavaharika Bhasha, was not easy for the company. Possibly they did this to please the Maharaja. And even when they did this, they prefaced the play with a prologue written in Sanskrit. The prologue introduces Gurdwara as an English language poet, Agla Bhasha Kavi, who enjoys reading playwrights such as Shakespeare, Moliere, and Ben Jonson, and who loves to import the English style of plays into Telugu. If you look at the reception of the press, the way this play was received, especially the English language press, which gave it rave reviews, the production was a great success. The second version of the play, which was published in 1909, has not been easy to perform as the first version. One of the reasons for it is it's very long. Gurdwara himself did not show much interest in the production of his plays. If we look at the entries in his diaries, they show that he was critical of the theatre of his time, which mostly produced mythological plays. He deplored the absence of a good theatre and good plays in Telugu, and he wrote in his preface to the second version of Kanyasulkam, and this preface he wrote in English. And there he writes that there is no theatre worth the name and no professional actors who practice acting as an art. There are not many good plays either. For almost a decade after its publication, the second version of the play did not receive attention of theater groups, while it was popularly read. Girisam and Madhuravani became household names. The language of the play its wonderful dialogues captivated, as I said, students, readers. However, it did not make it to the professional theater circuit. The play was staged after this for the first time in 1924 in Tenali with well-known actors. Later on, great stage and cinema actors in the Telugu language have played the roles of Girisa, Madhuravani, and the other various characters, and are remembered for these roles. The poet Abburi Ramakrishna Rao abridged the play in 1932, and this abridged version was staged a lot. Aitam Rajakumari, who was a famous actress, was well known for her portrayal of Madhuravani on stage. A.R. Krishna Rao, a famous artistic director of Hyderabad, played, he continued Abburi Ramakrishna Rao's tradition and played, staged the play. We have very important actors like J.V. Somayajulu and J.V. Ramanamurthy producing the play with their own innovative changes from 1953 for almost 25 years. Countless amateur groups, about which not much information is available, staged this play a number of times in various abridgments. In 1976, the Sahitya Academy published another abridged version of the play by the noted writer Narla Venkateswara Rao. The theme of the play became so very popular that many writers wrote sequels to it that imagined the afterlife of the main characters. As with most classic works, the play was made into a Telugu film in 1955, with, of course, a number of changes that a popular Telugu film requires. Most notable change of it was that Butchamma and Girisam get married at the end. You know, you get a happy ending at the end. And the Telugu film is extremely popular. It still is watched. We have N.T. Ramarao playing the role of Girisam, and the role of Madhuravani, the notch girl with the golden heart, is played by the actress Savitri. Extremely popular. So, and most people are, even if they have not read the play, are more aware with the film version. And, you know, they could almost, and since NTR and Savitri are big actors, most people, you know, remember the dialogues from that film as well. So, I stop here. I've been talking for quite some time. And in case there are questions, comments, suggestions, please feel free.
Thank you very much, Nishi ma'am. It was an amazing presentation, and like, we have come to know a lot about Telugu literature, Telugu play, and also about this very nice text, Kanya Sulkam. And ma'am, do you want to go to the question answer session? Should we start taking questions?
Yes.
Yeah, sure, ma'am. We have many comments as well as questions in the chat box. First, we'll start.
I see Vijay Kumar's. Yes, I understand. Vijay is here, yes, it is Karakata Sastri. Yes, I agree. Yes, and thank you for speaking about Bazaar. Yes, I think most people, I'm not sure if most of these young people are aware of that Hindi film Bazaar, which also speaks about contract marriages. Yes.
And also, if anyone wants to have any, like,
I should mention that Vijay Kumar was one of those people who translated Kanya Sulkam into English, along with C. Vijay Shree. He did translate the play, and I did read that version sometime, but unfortunately I don't have that translation with me. It's there at college and I'm stuck at home, so I could not read his this time I couldn't read his book.
I think
he is a better person to actually talk about the play.
If you want to Vijay Kumar to say something about this presentation.
He is the much better person to talk about the play rather than me.
So I will be glad to have you say something.
No, I just enjoyed listening to Nishi. So I don't think it's her session. I shouldn't be intruding. Yeah. So, I think a very comprehensive presentation, both contextualization of the play as well as the textual analysis. So I have nothing really to add. Except that, this is a landmark play because it both ushers in modernism and at the same time critiques it.
Mm-hmm.
So it happens very rarely that a text both ushers in a movement as well as critiques it, because usually a critique of a movement, and particularly a complex movement like modernism, happens only when certain years have passed and certain landmark texts appear in that particular movement, and only then there is a kind of a critique taking place. But here is a very unusual, I think, I would dare say that probably the rare example in not just in Telugu literature, but also in the entire Indian literary tradition, that you have a text both, which both introduces as well as critiques modernism in the same text. Because, as has been mentioned, Girisam is a very good example of both somebody who is modern, but at the same time, makes a mockery of modernism. Mm. And through that character, Kurozawa does something remarkable. And the second character through which Kurozawa actually also, in a way, makes fun of these idealist social reformers, mm-hmm. is the lawyer Saujanya Rao, who is shown to have, in a way, feet of clay. So idealism is fine, but that idealism, mm-hmm. is not rooted in reality.
Reality.
And therefore, I mean, there is so much that one can, say about the text. Mm-hmm. The very fact that Kurozawa's display was considered the first, as Nishi also pointed out, the first play in colloquial Telugu.
Mm-hmm.
But the ironic part is that this was also the first time that Kurozawa was actually writing in Telugu. He never wrote anything in Telugu before this. He wrote all his poems, all his letters, all his newspaper articles in English, and he continued to write his personal diary in English. So this is the first time that he actually wrote something in Telugu. And that's why there has always also been that controversy, like, who wrote Shakespeare? There was, mm-hmm. also a controversy about who wrote Kanyasulkam. Mm-hmm. Is it possible for a writer who never wrote anything in Telugu to write a play like this in Telugu? So who wrote Shakespeare? There is also, silly controversy, but there has been a debate, mm-hmm. about whether it was Kurozawa at all who wrote it, mm-hmm. and was it somebody else who wrote this play and Kurozawa used it and something like that. So there are many things about this play which makes it so interesting. Yeah, sorry, I spoke too.
No, thank you. No, it was wonderful having you, because I'm not the right kind of person to talk about it, but I really went back to it and I enjoyed going back and reading. I loved reading it.
Unfortunately, our image of a classic is that it is boring and unreadable.
Absolutely.
But this is one of those classics which, if people can overcome that mental, mm-hmm. Inhibition about reading classics,
mm-hmm.
If somebody actually opens the play and starts reading it, I'm sure, they would not stop.
Yes, and it's available in soft copy also. In case you're interested, if you could Google Kanyasulkam, you will get a PDF of the Penguin version is available in PDF form. So you could read the play. So, since we have students and scholars out here who who are interested in it. So you could read the play, and it's easy to read. I mean, the translation. I couldn't find your one online, Vijay. I didn't find your one, but both of them are, available. So you could read the text, and I think also, I mean, since most of you are familiar with Bangla literature as well, and I think it would be very interesting to compare and study it with various Bangla texts, which also speak about maybe not about Kanya Sulkam, not about the Sulka practice, but about the position of widows and about how English education and was making inroads and modernity.
Thank you very much, Nishi ma'am. Ma'am, I'll ask the participants if someone wants to have any comment or any question. They can.
Yeah, Jemima also mentioned the same film that Vijay mentions. Yes. I think you also refer to that film. I noticed that in your comments where you write about, you speak about another film, of course, Leeches, where you notice the malpractice of Bride Bazaar in Hyderabad. I have not seen this film, but the film that Vijay spoke about, Bazaar, that's the one that I had seen, but this one I have not. Maybe go back to it at some point of time. Yes. And there's Shushri who also mentions about another practice which is there in the Afghan culture called the Dukhmani, which is a variant of Kanya Sulkam. And we have even Vijay talking about that bride prowse widely practiced in many parts of Africa. So I think there'll be resonances in various cultures as well.
All these patriarchal concepts and practices, like even now we see many places happening. And ma'am, there is one question from Nidula Sharma. She's saying, is there some reason due to which Ramkrishna Rao's abridged version was widely staged while the original version wasn't?
I think it has to do with the size of the play. It's a very long play. Okay. Right. I think it has to do with the size of the play.
Okay. And then there is Dharan Ghosh. He's saying, ma'am, thank you for such an insightful session. Can you tell us more about the linguistic feathers of the play in reference to the spoken Telugu movement and the reaction in support of the Grandhika Bhasha?
Ayon, I'm a wrong person. I did not read the play in Telugu. Let me make that right statement right at the beginning. I read the play in the English version. Right. So I am not very comfortable with Telugu itself, with the Telugu language. So I would not be able to talk about, and I mean, about what he's asking out here, the linguistic aspect of the play, no. Excepting for the fact that it's written in the colloquial idiom, not in a stylized Telugu, which was earlier the case. I won't be able to add much to that.
And then we have Brinda's comment. You said this play was taken as a film. Like this, Silapathikaram was also taken as a film named Pumpuka, starring S.S. Rajendran and Vijay Kumari.
This was a very popular Telugu film, Kanya Sulkam. It's available on YouTube. Yeah. In case you want to watch it, you can do it. I am sure you could even get subtitles, so you could watch it. It's a very old film, black and white film, but in case you are interested, you could read the play. As I said, it's available. PDFs are available, and the text is also available. I mean, if you want to buy them, you would get copies of it, and you could watch the film as well.
And then we have one comment from Suparna, one of our co-founder of Calcutta Comparatist. According to her, I think there are some texts in Bengali about similar practice. I forgot the name, maybe Olik Babu or Jessica Taisa. Yeah, actually, we have many texts about in Bengali related to similar practices.
But I don't think in the Bengali text speak about the monetary transaction, right? Na, a sulka price ta bodhay nahi. Kintu
no, no, ma'am. Konna pon bola hoto.
Acha.
There was this practice long ago.
Mane ei shomoy ta 19th century.
Similar, mane ei shomoy.
হতেই পারে বিকজ মানে ইন্ডিয়ান সোসাইটি মোরালেস তো একই রকমের ছিল, হতেই পারে সেটা। হ্যাঁ, আই এম নট ভেরি অ্যাওয়ার অফ ইট, বাট বাট দ্য চাইল্ড উইডো, দ্য স্টেটাস অফ উইডো, এগুলো তো কমন এলিমেন্টস। আই এম শিওর ইউ উইল কাম অ্যাক্রস আ নাম্বার অফ বেঙ্গলি
মেনি টেক্সট ফ্রম কলোনিয়াল অ্যাজ ওয়েল অ্যাজ দ্য পোস্ট কলোনিয়াল পিরিয়ড।
Absolutely, absolutely.
And then, like, I personally like, want to ask you something. Like, in Kanya Sulkam, we see there is this clash between modernity and traditions, and like, it kind of reflects in also in Fakir Mohan Sinha with this Chhama Nata Gunta.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Also, in Sindhu Lekha, maybe the Malayalam novel.
Absolutely.
Can you come and like say something on that?
I did when I was I didn't speak about it, but this play was written, I think, almost at the same time. It was published in the same year that Fakir Mohan Senapati began serializing his novel, Chhama Nata Gunta. Right, and there are similarities. However, I think Gurjara's play is more directly oriented towards social reforms. Right, I did come across that the reference to Fakir Mohan Senapati, but Indulekha I am not aware of. I am not sure about it.
Yeah, actually, like there was, I think, one seminar that was held in probably in Delhi, maybe, and eminent professors like Satyapriya Mohanty and other Harish Trivedi, they were present. And in this that seminar, someone read a paper or presented a paper on the comparative study between Kanya Sulkam and Chhama Nata Gunta. I think I also read that somewhere.
Yes, because there are a lot of similarities. They were written almost at the same point of time. Yeah, so obviously there would be resonances somewhere. Yes.
And I think the many aspects of the of this play, it resonates in many other Indian literature as well. In other literature texts of the colonial period, maybe.
Yes. Yes, as I said right at the beginning, you know, I'm not an expert at all on Telugu literature. I was kind of coaxed into speaking on it. I enjoyed, you know, reading the text, going back to it after a very long time. But yes, there are a lot of resonances, you know, because I see, you know, when I was trying to locate the text in the scenario, you see the kind of things that I was talking about that were happening in the 19th century was happening. Was seen here in Bengal as well, and was seen in various parts of India at that same point, at the point of time. So the social climate was more or less the same, right? So we will have a lot of resonances between texts. And as students of literature, I think it is our job to find out these resonances. And, you know, as Vijay said, you know, even today, if you read them, I for instance, enjoyed reading the play after a long, long time. So it's really very interesting to read it all over again. So do read it if you are interested.
I hope many of us who have not read the play will now just want to take up the book and read it as soon as possible. I think it's a very interesting text. And
yeah, my point was basically to just introduce you to a text, you know, which is iconic. Even after so many years since its publication, it's still a very important text in Telugu literature and in Indian literature too.
And like, it is very relevant in the contemporary times as well. It's very relevant.
Yes, absolutely.
Everything going on around us is so relevant. And
absolutely.
If there is anyone who wants to ask any question or has any comments about this session, you can unmute your mic, maybe write in the chat box as well. Or else we'll just let people read more about Kanya Sulkam and can conclude the session for today. And thank you, Manishi ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us today. And participants, will let you know more about our upcoming lectures. It will be, you can join our book. You can. I think Jemima is saying something.
I was just thanking, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you so much.
No, this is a nice collective that you have, you know, where you're going to discuss about various things. That's a nice thing to do, you know, keep each of you connected and at the same time, you know, discuss various texts. Not everyone knows everything, so
yeah,
it's nice when we discuss, talk about various things. I keep seeing your various activities. It's not possible to join always, but it's nice to know. I mean, since you have, we get a YouTube recording of this, so maybe
we'll upload
your various lectures that you organize. Thank you so much, all of you, Calcutta Comparatists 1919. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you,
ma'am.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for joining us today.
Bye bye.
Good night. And good night, so let you know more about our upcoming lectures.